Welcome to our new series called What Instrument Should I Play? Today, we're very fortunate to have Stephanie Corwin here with her bassoon to talk about a rather unusual instrument. Welcome, Stephanie.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. Here are all the parts of the bassoon, some necessities. So we start, this is the boot joint, this is the bottom. You'll see it has two holes. So in one of those holes, we then put the wing joint, which is called a wing joint because it has this curve. So it sort of curves around like a little wing. Put that in one of the holes. And then we have the long joint, because it's the longest joint. And then the last piece that we put on is the bell. It goes up top. And then there's one last little bit, and that's the bocal. So it's this curvy piece of metal that we put here. And that's the bassoon.
Do they all come apart in four pieces like that?
They do, yes. So it makes it very convenient for carrying around.
Yes, it's a little long.
So that's the bassoon itself, but we need something else to make the sound.
Yes.
Right? Because this doesn't do anything by just blow. You don't really get much of a sound.
Not much. Not much there.
So,
okay, so
that's what I have over here. My very well-loved reed box contains a bunch of bassoon reeds that I all make myself.
What does it sound like if you just blow on one of the reeds?
So then the reed goes on to the bocal. It's just like that.
Okay.
So then now.
What is the range?
So the range, the bassoon has a very large range, so we're very lucky. So this is the lowest member of the woodwind family, so we can play pretty low. And then we can also play quite high up to into the treble clef. So. And one interesting fact I just noticed while we're thinking about how it's put together. So you notice how there's the two holes here and these two joints. So essentially, this is one long tube. So we're starting here.
Yes.
And it goes here through the bocal and then down here. And then makes a U-turn at the bottom. It looks like a U under there. Comes up this way. So we actually have 8 feet.
Oh,
tube
wow.
That's folded up in half.
No wonder so that's, it can play so low.
Exactly, so that's why it can play so low. Also has lots of keys, so one of the special things about the bassoon is that our thumbs do a lot of work. So all these keys on this side are just for our two thumbs.
This is pretty heavy.
Yes.
So how do you play with this?
So very often, most of the time, we use called a seat strap, so this little bit of leather,
mm-hmm.
with a hook on it that hooks conveniently into the bottom of the bassoon. And then if you take a chair, it's really quite clever. So you just, it's very simple but smart. You just lay the strap on the seat and then you sit on it to hold it in place.
Well, if you didn't recognize that was from Peter and the Wolf, you certainly should listen to it. How old were you when you began to play the bassoon?
I think I was around 13, 12 or 13.
Okay.
I was in seventh grade in middle school, but I had previously played other instruments. So I started playing piano when I was very young, when I was about 3.5.
Mm-hmm.
And then I knew when I was approaching sixth grade, which is where I grew up, that's when you start having the opportunity to play in band or orchestra. And so I started playing saxophone in sixth grade and had fun, but I there were also just a lot of people playing the saxophone.
Yes.
Where I was. I was sort of looking ahead and thinking that when I got to high school, being in the orchestra was also something I'd like to do. And with the saxophone, that's not not a very common instrument in the orchestra. So, so around the same time that these thoughts were going through my head, then our band director introduced the oboe and the bassoon, because often they wait a little bit. They wait about a year later than the other instruments because they are a little bit more complicated. So he presented the oboe, and I didn't want to play that because my sister was playing it, so that would be boring. but then I saw the bassoon and thought, oh, well, that looks intriguing. So I actually ended up renting an instrument from the principal bassoonist of the Atlanta Symphony, which was great because he had this, it was a wooden instrument. A lot of the beginner instruments are made of plastic, which is also fine for starting out, but there's something, the wood has a different quality to the sound, which is nice. But I remember I went over to his house to pick up the instrument. He taught me a few notes, and I looked down, and on the boot joint, there were teeth marks from where his dog had chewed on it.
Oh no!
Years ago. And so that was always like a very special instrument.
Yes. Yeah. You have to be a certain size to play the bassoon.
It's true, yeah. That's one thing for bassoonists is that we typically don't start until a later age, and usually around 12 or 13 is the earliest you can comfortably start, because your hands do have to be a certain size to wrap around and be able to get to these thumb keys without pressing down other ones that might get in the way. So like if your hands are too small, if you try to push this down, you're often gonna get the D key as well. So little things like that. It's also just, you know, the weight of the instrument. And it's also good to have your adult teeth at that point too. Just have like the embouchure a little bit more mature.
Yeah.
So we get a little bit of a late start compared to other instruments.
What was your first teacher like?
She was fantastic. She was very kind, but also like didn't let you get away with a lot too. Uh-huh. You know,
which is important if you're in the seventh grade.
Totally.
I gather you played in bands and orchestras going through high school.
Mm-hmm.
At what point did you decide this might be a career?
It took me a little bit of time to come to that. When it was time to go to college, I sort of knew that that was a possibility, but I wasn't confident enough to go all in and go to a conservatory and focus only on playing the bassoon. So I went to liberal arts college, and after my first year there, I went to a music festival in the summer.
Yes.
And I think that was the moment where I was suddenly, you know, really immersed in this place where you're just surrounded by other musicians and making music all the time in all sorts of different orchestras and chamber ensembles and a variety of contexts. And yeah, that's when it just clicked. And I said, oh, I would love to do this for my the rest of my life.
How did you end up in New York?
So eventually I went to a lot of school in various places. So I sort of worked my way up. So I went to undergrad in North Carolina. And then after that, I came up to Yale in New Haven, Connecticut for my master's. Mm-hmm. Then after that, I got my doctorate on Long Island at Stony Brook. Mm-hmm. And during that time, I moved into New York City. And then I also pursued another single year of study of historical bassoons at Indiana University.
Well, thank you, Stephanie.
You're very welcome.
This has been great having you, and we look forward to hearing you around town.
Thank you.
Okay. Take care.